The views and opinions expressed by this content creator do not necessarily reflect the views and opinions of the ad agencies that are running ads on this content creator's content or videos.
Well, hello everyone. Are you having trouble sleeping at night? Having trouble balancing your work schedule and your life schedule? Trying to fit in those precious moments with the moments where you need to go to work so you can make money so that you can live and have food and shelter. And you know, I understand that when you get off work at 8 o'clock at night, but you know, you want to spend time with friends and family and doing things that are genuinely important in life. That it's really hard to turn around and be back at work at 6 in the morning. Well, that's okay. If you can't sleep because of swing shift syndrome, because your work has got you working odd hours, and it's incompatible with real life, take a drug. There's plenty of drugs out there to help you sleep. We have things like benzodiazepines. We have Lunesta, as well as Ambien. Many different drugs to help you sleep. Are you waking up feeling groggy, tired, sluggish? And you go to your boss and you say, I'm sorry, I'm late, I just slept in, having trouble sleeping. And they say, that's okay. You should take some sleeping pills. And when you're tired and groggy, well, that's okay. You should take some more drugs. Drugs like caffeine and nicotine. And if those aren't strong enough, you should go to the underground market and look into cocaine and meth. You know, it always struck me as odd that in our civilization, industrial revolution, that we oftentimes do things that are incompatible with human nature. We have a thing called circadian rhythm. It monitors what time we feel tired, when we sleep, how much we sleep. And when that's interrupted, the answer that society gives to us is to take narcotics and drugs that are highly addictive. And they don't really solve the problem, the overall problem. The answer isn't maybe the scheduling system that we have in our society is just not compatible with human nature or the biology of the human brain. No, that's not the answer. The answer is alter the brain chemistry so that it is compatible with what we created, instead of creating something that is compatible with the human brain's biology. I always found this to be absurd and strange. It is unhealthy to have an irregular sleep pattern. Very unhealthy. In fact, the psychological studies have shown that it just gets worse and worse as the schedule changes. Really early in the morning is okay. And then as it gets later on, in the, like midday is probably the best. Midday, like in a 9 to 5 job, an 11 to 7 job, that's probably the best hours for human beings to be awake and functioning at. And it's not just the brain's biology, it's our actual physical body's biology too. There were studies that were showing that there are certain hours of the day where our blood is more congealed than at other times. When we first wake up in the morning, it is not recommended to do strenuous activity, including working out, doing exercises, because your blood is really thick when you first wake up, and it actually increases your rate of heart attack and stroke. When you're young, you don't have much to worry about, but as you get older, this is something that becomes a problem. The lack of sleep can actually cause problems with your cognitive ability, your ability to assess situations, process information. Your brain has a harder time processing the information. It really does. Your cognitive ability starts just going down the toilet with the inconsistency of sleep, lack of sleep, sleep deprivation. It also weakens your immune system. You would think that companies out there in society would want a healthy working body to sustain society and the growth of society so that they can be a worker bee in the sense that they're fully there, fully cognitive, and capable of doing strenuous activities without just collapsing on the job and causing extreme health problems. But no, that's not what we do. We say drugs. And there is no short amount of drugs out there on the market. There's even a drug that they can prescribe to you for what they call swing shift syndrome. Back though to the hours, because I kind of got off subject on that. As you go into the overnight shifts, they've seen a dramatic deterioration in cognitive function, so much to the point where it even starts to cause problems such as depression and mood problems. You know, like irritability and stuff like that. And it gets even worse when you get into swing shifts. Swing shift is probably the worst thing you can do to the human psyche and to the human biology. And our answer to it is not reforming society or the company saying, we don't want to do this to our workers. The answer is, I'll take melatonin. Take something to sleep at night, you know, because you're not ready to sleep when you get off work because your biological clock, your circadian rhythm says, no, it's not time. So you take a drug to induce it. You become physically and mentally dependent on that for sleep. So even on your days off, you still have to take the damn drug to go to sleep. And you know, there are sufficient reasons to take these drugs. There are literally people that have just genetically something messed up with their circadian rhythm where they can't sleep even if they have a stable schedule. And there are people like me that have generalized anxiety and panic disorder where I have to take something that shuts down my central nervous system. Otherwise, my body will just constantly be pumping itself full of adrenaline, and I will literally sleep only 3 or 4 hours a night, and my cognitive ability will just slowly deteriorate over time. I mean, it's nasty. So I take a drug that sometimes is prescribed for sleep, not very often. It's usually prescribed solely for panic and anxiety disorders. And the whole purpose of it is to cut the central nervous system off, so you suppress it, so you're not experiencing that large rush of adrenaline and that hypersensitivity. And there are, like I said, there are real reasons for people to consume drugs like Lunesta and Ambien, people with legitimate sleep problems. Like they legitimately just can't do it, not because their circadian rhythm has been messed up, but because they have a genetic disposition for it being messed up. That is a legitimate reason to be taking that medication. Or on short-term reasons, to take the medication, like the loss of a loved one, and you can't sleep because you're in turmoil over grieving. And yeah, maybe it would be necessary to take a drug to make you sleep, but only for a short period of time. That I can see. But then, you know, it gets even more interesting. It's like, you know, when you're sluggish and slow in the morning, almost every company I see offers coffee. This is a narcotic. It is an addictive drug with no social stigma whatsoever. And it is responsible for deaths. Yeah, that's right. Caffeine has killed people. Nicotine can kill people. It doesn't actually, the actual chemical compound of nicotine, it doesn't take that much to actually kill you. 1 micromilliliter, I believe, is what it is. So a single drop of pure nicotine and 1 micromilliliter, just an eye drop, on your tongue would make your heart explode. Here are some other wonderful drug substances that are used to keep you awake, that some of them do have caffeine and other chemicals as well. Not very healthy, but still readily available on the market, over the counter. Blowed. Not literally, you know. But it would give out. Your heart would stop. It's too much. It's a very potent stimulant. And there are even people that work in these types of environments, such as truck drivers, people in the health industry, which I think the health industry has actually taken a look at and said, you know, maybe we need to do something different with sleep cycles and shifts and stuff to make it so where they are not going through this sleep deprivation thing, because a lot of people were turning to meth, which deteriorates your cognitive ability and can give you such things as amphetamine psychosis. It damages the pleasure center of your brain to where you can't, your brain no longer is really producing dopamine, and the only way you can get pleasure, the sense of pleasure out of eating, having sex, watching TV, drinking, anything that would normally be a stimulus to give, to release dopamine in your brain stops functioning, and the only way you can get that dopamine receptors to kick back on again is by consuming more meth. So anyone that tells you that meth is not addictive, they're full of shit. Ask them, can you lay a bag of meth out in front of you and not consume it? They'll say yes, but more often than not, they can't do it. They will pace back and forth in front of that bag of meth going, just pulling their hair, grinding their teeth, and thinking about using it. It's not a physical addiction, it's a mental addiction like nicotine, times a million. And unfortunately, the unfortunate thing of meth addiction is that it can last up to 7 years. It can take 7 years for your brain to recover from methamphetamine addiction. 7 years. 5 to 7 years. There are actually case studies where it has been shown that people who have been clean from meth for 2 years are still suffering from amphetamine psychosis. That's after 2 years of being clean. It literally can take 5 to 7 years to heal. Nicotine withdrawals, the actual withdrawal symptoms of nicotine, are only 48 hours. That's right. What most people are actually addicted to with nicotine is the habitual habit of doing this. It becomes an obsessive compulsion. And that's the real problem with cigarettes, is that you've turned an addiction into an obsessive compulsive behavior. That's what makes quitting cigarettes so hard. Not so much the nicotine. The nicotine addiction is actually only lasts, the withdrawal symptoms really only last for 48 hours. After that, the craving comes from that longing of that physical activity of doing something, because for some reason your mind associates smoking a cigarette with actually doing something productive. Don't know why, but it does. Vaping has actually been very, very successful in getting people to quit smoking cigarettes. In fact, I didn't even intend on quitting smoking cigarettes when I started vaping. I started vaping because, at the time, the company I was working for didn't want me to be seen in uniform smoking a cigarette. So, I switched to vaping, and I vaped while I was on the job, and I ended up vaping for 2 days, or I think it was a day straight. And I tried lighting up a cigarette, and I had to put it out because it tasted disgusting. My sense of smell, my sense of taste came back to me, and I can't do it anymore. Anymore, if I smoke a cigarette, my tonsils just flare up. They swell. They go poof. I can't do it. Vape only now. I didn't intend on quitting cigarettes. I didn't intend on it. It just happened. But already, my respiratory system works a lot better. I don't wake up in the morning needing to hack up a huge sludge of mush. I don't have breathing problems anymore. There's just, like I said, my sense of smell, my sense of taste. A lot of things have happened since I quit smoking cigarettes that are really quite good that those problems went away. Why is it that society is mainly, I'm not so sure if it's society, or I think it's a societal issue, where we're saying drugs are the answer to the problem, when the problem is that we're doing things in society that are not compatible with human biology. If we did things that were more compatible, like on a sleep scale, as far as the circadian rhythm and stuff, maybe we wouldn't need to consume drugs to go to sleep or become dependent on them for sleep. Maybe we wouldn't become dependent on drugs to keep us awake, like caffeine and nicotine, or sometimes people even resorting to meth. Maybe that wouldn't be the case. I've often found it interesting how society does things like that. That's actually a common theme in the goth counterculture. As we've pointed out societal issues that people don't want to think about. And this is one that I'm pointing out to you right now. Why is it that we create our work structure, our work environment, around something that is incompatible with the human brain chemistry, biology, and human biology in general? Why don't we create a schedule that is compatible with human biology? That's what I think the real answer is. Not getting people hooked on drugs. And when I say hooked, when we're talking about pills that make you sleep, we're not talking about a euphoria. We're talking about a drug that has no euphoric effect whatsoever. It's just, shit, I can't fucking sleep without this stuff anymore. That's kind of a fucked up thing to do, to say you have to become a drug addict in order to essentially be a functioning member of society. I do believe not all Western civilizations do this. Some of them have refused to be 24-hour societies. And I think there is some pros to being 24-hour societies. Some of us, like myself, are kind of nocturnal. I really like being awake at night. I do. Usually, left on my own devices without any schedule to really worry about, my natural circadian rhythm usually falls in this pattern. I go to sleep around 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning and wake up anywhere between 11 and 12 in the afternoon. That's left on my own devices. That's what my body naturally does on its own. So that's a question that I pose to society out there, a question that I think people should think about is, when you go to your boss and you say, I'm really sorry I'm late, I'm having trouble sleeping, I guarantee you a lot of the times they'll say, well, have you tried this medication or this over-the-counter, this drug you buy over-the-counter, you know, like melatonin? Have you tried that to get to sleep? I would stay away from that. I really would. Because eventually, your circadian rhythm will stop functioning properly and you will become dependent on melatonin for sleep. And or you could even develop a tolerance to it where it no longer works. It's true. It is absolutely true. And you'll have to switch to something like an allergy medication, like, what is it called? Well, this is Equate's version of allergy relief, but it's, you know, Benadryl, along with a plethora of others. I would say that's not the way. I would say that it would be better if we as a society started looking at our own biology, scientifically looking at our biology, the chemical makeup of our own brain, and saying, well, what is really compatible with human biology? That, I think, is a healthier thing to do. Of course, a lot of people ignore science nowadays, and I'm not sure why. Science has deeply enriched our lives. Pretty much everything you do, unless you live in the woods. Okay, and I'm not talking in a cabin with electricity. I'm talking about, like, making your own spears and arrows and hunting your own food and making your fire by rubbing sticks together. And even then, you're still kind of using science. This is science. How I'm getting this video to you is science. The lighting is science. The technology I use to improve the mic pickup is science. To improve the audio quality is science. Your television, your computer, all of it is science. You can thank science for that. The things that we have in the medical industry, even veterinarian science, has caused our animals to live longer. People live longer. It's because of science. And maybe we could live healthier lives if we allowed science to do research into these things and say, this is incompatible with human biology, and actually look at that and say, okay, now we know. We should devise something that is compatible with human biology so that people can live happier, healthier, more fulfilling lives without depriving them of sleep or social interaction. Social interaction is important. Look at Maslow's hierarchy of needs. So, I think that's it for this topic. I know this is kind of out of left field. Like, where does that come from? But I kind of do that. I like doing debunking stuff. So, I hope you enjoyed the video. Don't forget to like, share, subscribe, and comment. Hit the bell button. I know it's getting old hearing about the bell. But if you don't hit the bell button, you could... And this goes for any YouTube channel you subscribe to. Hit the bell button. If you don't, you could be automatically unsubscribed. Don't know why. That's YouTube's decision. So, thank you for watching. Like I said, like, share, subscribe, hit the bell button. And with that, I'm out.